The America Falls Omnibus, Books 1 through 11, written by Scott Medbury, narrated by Adam Barr. Hell Week, Book 1 of the America Falls series, Part 1, Hell Breaks Loose. 1. I don't think about death anymore. It takes too much energy, and God knows I need every bit of that. My name is Isaac Race. Both of my parents are dead, and so is my sister, Rebecca. They were dead even before the attack. In fact, everyone I ever loved or cared about before is gone now. I can't complain, though. The others have lost everybody, too, all except the twins, Ben and Brooke. They have each other, at least. I guess I need to start at the beginning, before the shit hit the fan, as my last foster father used to say. Yeah, I said my last foster father. I had two after my parents died. That's where I'll begin my story, just before the Pyongyang flu killed all the grown-ups. Well, nearly all of them. Mom, Dad, and Rebecca were killed in a house fire just before I turned 14. I wasn't at home that Saturday night. I'd stayed over at my best friend Tommy's house. The cops and social workers all told me how lucky I was. I didn't feel lucky. For a long time, I kind of wished I'd been home. Maybe I could have saved them. Or if not, at least I would have died too. Surely that would have been better than the awful, empty feeling that is only now starting to fade. If I died with them, we would have gone to heaven together. Well, that's what I thought back then, when it first happened. I know there isn't a heaven now. There can't be a heaven without a God, and I know there can't be a God. No God could have let them do what they've done to us. Could he? For years, America had been worried about North Korea getting nukes. It was confirmed during Trump's presidency, and things had gotten really tense. Missile tests, insults, and threats only ramped up the pressure. Kim Jong-un had eventually moderated his tone, and there had been meetings and diplomacy, but things always seemed to be close to boiling point, even into the next presidency. Throw in Putin's Russia making moves in Europe, and the main threats to the USA and everyone else seemed clear. Boy, had they been wrong. While the Pentagon's attention was diverted, the enemy they'd really needed to be concerned with was making plans and working on their strategies for expansion. It had suited them perfectly for North Korea and Russia to keep stirring the pot, keeping all the attention off them. None of it really matters now, I guess. What happened, happened, and we're the ones left to deal with the consequences. And all too frequently, that consequence is death. Just look at Sarah. She was the first that Luke and I found. She was a good kid, and only just beginning to come out of the shell she'd retreated into after Hell Week. Dogs got her. A pack had been stalking us for a few miles. They were hungry and mean. I'll never forget her screams. We shot three of them, but not before they'd nearly torn her arm off. But I'm getting ahead of myself. My world changed 2 years before everyone else's did, too. Dad didn't arrive to pick me up from Tommy's at 10 a.m., the arranged time, on the Sunday morning. I called home at 10:30 to see where he was, and all I got was the shrill beep, beep, beep of a busy signal. Mr. Benson asked me what my dad's cell phone number was, but I didn't know it. "I'm sure he won't be much longer," he said, almost managing to mask his annoyance. Tommy and I went back to his room to play Xbox while we waited. When 2 hours passed with no word, the Bensons gave me some lunch. "Tommy and I will drop you home after we eat." I know it sounds weird, but I kind of knew that something wasn't right. I'd had a strange feeling all that morning, a sense that something bad was going to happen. I didn't know it then, but it had already happened. When Mr. Benson turned onto our street, I knew before I saw them that there would be fire trucks. I don't know how, but I did. Sure enough, there they were, impossibly red on that bright, sunny, horrible afternoon. My house was a blackened pile of rubble, the remains of a rotten tooth and the perfect smile of big, neat houses that lined our cul-de-sac. Mr. Benson said the F-bomb under his breath and ran a hand through his thick hair. That word would normally have elicited sniggers from Tommy and me. Not that day. I think I was already in shock, and even Tommy had been stunned into an unusual silence. Mr. Benson was saying something to me when we pulled up. I didn't hear, though. The rushing sound in my head drowned everything out. I didn't want to open the door. It felt like when I did, I would be opening a door into another existence.
Isaac, stay here with Tommy. I'll talk to the police officer.
Mr. Benson's words finally cut through the fog in my head. It's okay, I said, and pushing past the dread, I opened the door. Noise assaulted my senses, people yelling, water from fire hoses sizzling on smoldering timber, someone crying. By the mailbox, the one surviving man-made construction on our lot, our beer-bellied neighbor, Bob Johnson, was talking to a police officer. His hair was wild and his face smudged with soot. Isaac, he yelled and rushed over. I took a step back, but he caught me and pulled me into a tight hug. Thank God you're okay, Isaac. He began to sob, his big gut moving up and down against me as his tears wet my cheek. We stood that way for a long time. I didn't know what to say or how to escape his hug. Every time he tried to say something, he broke into sobs again. Finally, I heard a man's voice over his shoulder. Mr. Johnson, please, I'll talk to the boy. I stumbled a little as the big man let me go. The officer put a steadying hand on my shoulder and guided me to the fence that separated our two properties. That day is still a blur, but I remember looking back at the smoking mess that had been my home before the officer turned me back toward the street. That was worse. Tommy stood there with his dad's arm around his shoulder, identical looks of pity on their faces, and for the first time it hit me that I would never feel my dad's arm around me again. I started to weep as the officer spoke to me. I'm so sorry, son. I want you to know that your family wouldn't have felt a thing. It looks like the fire started in the kitchen, and they would have been sound asleep. The smoke going through the house meant they didn't wake up or feel pain. He paused, as if unsure how to go on. Do you have family we can call and get you looked after? Grandparents, aunts or uncles, anyone close by? I tried to man up, ashamed of my tears. Funny what things seem important to a 13-year-old. I shook my head. There's no one. I sniveled. All of my grandparents are dead, and I don't have uncles or aunts.
It's okay, son. We'll have someone take care of you. Here, come and sit in the patrol car while I make some calls.
The cop turned and headed off to his cruiser. I glanced at the crowd of people that watched from across the street and saw my dad looking right across at me. It was only a second before I realized it wasn't him, just a guy with a beard and similar colored hair. I felt a fresh stab of loss. That would happen a lot over the next few months. I would be doing something mundane, something where my mind was on autopilot, and I would think I saw one of them. Dad or Mom or Rebecca. At a bus stop. In a supermarket, in a queue at Starbucks. It was a cruel trick of the mind that allowed the reality of my loss to sock me in the guts over and over again. The cop stopped when he realized I wasn't following and reached for my hand. I absently shook him off and trailed him to the cruiser. He opened the door to the front passenger seat and I climbed in. I looked around, my boy's curiosity at being in a police car surfacing through the well of grief for just a moment. I managed to stop crying and wipe my eyes as I listened to the cop make a call back to base. I knew it was about me, but didn't really absorb what was being said. As he signed off, Tommy's dad approached.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.